Building a Raspberry Pi cluster usually means dealing with messy cables, stacks of boards, and a tangle of power supplies. But what if you could shrink that all down into a single compact board? This is the Sipeed NanoCluster. It's essentially a board and enclosure that allows you to run multiple Pi compute modules together as a compact cluster. This product is still in development, but you can pre-order it from their website. Pre-order pricing varies through the variety of options available, but essentially starts at $49 for the basic package, which is the bare bones board and fan without any adapters, and this goes up to $699 for the package with four of Sipeed's M4N modules and adapters. I think this is great value when you consider that you're basically getting an 8-port managed gigabit switch, 8 power supplies, as well as cabling and cooling, all for less than the price of a single Pi CM5 module. Sipeed have sent me what looks to be their CM4-5 package, which includes the NanoCluster board, the fan, and then 7 adapter boards, which can be used with the Raspberry Pi Compute Module 4 or 5s, with a bit of a caveat that we'll get to a little later. This package sells for $99. They also included this 3D printed 2-part enclosure, which I have with a clear top and a white top. It doesn't look like this is available as part of their pre-order offering, but it'll probably make its way there eventually. And they provide the 3D print files for it on MakerWorld if you'd like to print your own. First, let's take a look at the NanoCluster board itself. The board has 7 SOM or system on module slots, which are each dual M.2 M-key vertical slots. And these are then connected to an 8-port RISC-V based gigabit networking switch at the bottom. This is a managed switch with a web dashboard for configuration, which is kind of cool to see on something this small. The slots are directly compatible with Sipeed's LongM3H modules, and then the M4N modules, as well as the Pi CM4 and CM5 modules through these adapter boards. You also don't have to populate all the slots with the same modules. You can mix and match them too if that better suits your needs. To power the modules, it's got a USB-C port that supports power delivery up to 20 volts or 65 watts, and then an optional PoE expansion module. I don't have this module, but it plugs into these headers, which will then also provide up to 60 watts. These supplies are set up to provide redundancy, so you can have them both connected, and the system will then continue to run if one drops out. So they've even taken care of all of the stuff that usually leads to having lots of messy cables and adapters. Once you have the modules in place, you can literally just plug in a power supply and network cable, or just a PoE network cable, and the cluster will be ready to go. Alongside the USB-C power inputs, interfaces include 2 USB 2.0 ports, a gigabit Ethernet port, and an HDMI port. These are all connected to slot 1, as slot 1 is intended to be the master node. It also has the ability to manage power to the other slots. At the back of the NanoCluster board, and mounted into the case, we've got a 60mm 5V fan. This is a 2-pin fan, so it isn't PWM controlled. It'll just run at full speed permanently. Although this is a noisy solution, it probably makes sense because if you connect the fan up to any single module, then there's potential for it to not be running at full speed when some of the other modules might require it to be. There are also 7 indicator LEDs in front of the fan, which indicate the status of each node, and then 7 independent UART ports for debugging and control. All up, it measures 88x57mm, which then becomes 100x60x60mm with the fan and all of the slots populated with the modules. Next, we've got the carrier boards. These aren't required if you're using Sipeed's LM3H modules, but are needed for the Pi CM4 and CM5 modules, as well as Sipeed's M4N modules. On the front of each adapter board are the connectors for the compute module to plug into. Then on the back, along the edge is a USB-C port for flashing the module, and above that is a boot button. Below that's a microSD card slot for the OS image, and an M.2 slot for an NVMe SSD across the back. This will fit a 2242 or 2230 size drive. In terms of choosing modules for your cluster, the cheapest option is probably going to be for the LM3H modules, and the most powerful option, at least on paper, is to go with their 8-core M4N modules, allowing you to run up to 56 cores in this small footprint. Now, this obviously isn't going to replace your local Amazon data center, but it does allow you to build a very lightweight and relatively inexpensive cluster at home, which you can use to run Kubernetes, your own language models, IoT projects, or self-host systems as part of your Homelab setup. Now let's move on to that caveat that I spoke about in the beginning. Because the board only supports 60 watts of power input, and because of the compact footprint, there are some limits on how many of each module you can run in it. Sipeed recommend only running 4 CM5 or M4N modules at once, especially if you're powering them over PoE or running them with SSDs. You can also run up to 6 CM4 or LM3H modules, and if you're running the CM4 modules without SSDs and on the power delivery supply, then you'll probably be able to run all 7 without any issues. Then there's one more limitation, and that's with space. If you're using any form of heatsink or an SSD on the modules, then you can only really fit 4 in, as you'll need to skip a slot between each pair to provide space for them. For testing, I ordered a full set of 7 CM5 modules, but I'll go with Sipeed's recommendation and only run 4 of them. These are all the light modules, so they don't have Wi-Fi or Bluetooth, and I'll pair them with a microSD card for storage. I'm using microSD cards since the tests I'm going to be doing don't really need the speed of an SSD. So each adapter gets a Pi-5 compute module as well as a microSD card, and it then plugs into the NanoCluster board. In preparation for this video, I also got these CM5 heatsinks, but they're just way too thick to install for the build, so I'll see how it goes without them to start, and we can always try and add a small stick-on heatsink if we run into thermal issues. With the CM5 modules installed on the board and the board in the enclosure, let's try set up the cluster and do some performance testing on it. To test it out as a cluster, rather than just 4 individual computers, I'm going to be running the prime number test script that I ran on my 8-node water-cooled Pi cluster a few years ago. This is a Python script that runs through each number from 1 to a defined limit to check its divisibility to figure out if it's prime or not. It's an inefficient way of searching for prime numbers, but that is the point. The script is supposed to be computationally expensive so that the processor has to work hard. I'm going to run the test on an individual node first and then on the cluster. I'll run 3 tests on each, first searching to 10,000, then to 100,000, and then lastly to 200,000. These are the same tests I ran last time, so we can do a rough comparison between this 4-node Pi-5 cluster and that 8-node Pi-4 cluster. On the single node, I got the following results. Checking to 10,000 took 0.68 seconds, to 100,000 took 56 seconds, and to 200,000 took 213 seconds, or just under 4 minutes. I then ran the same script using MPI across the 4-node cluster. Checking to 10,000 was now reduced to 0.19 seconds, to 100,000 took just 14 seconds, and to 200,000 took just under a minute, at 58 seconds. So each test was a little under 4 times faster. Interestingly, this 4-node Pi-5 cluster beat the 8-node Pi-4 cluster's results, and the Pi-4s were overclocked to 2 GHz too. Now I know the Pi-5s are running at their stock 2.4 GHz, which is obviously higher than the overclocked Pi-4s, but there's only half as many of them. I then ran a stress test to check how the cluster handled thermals and power consumption. At idle, the 4-node CM5 cluster runs at about 14 watts. They say that the board itself uses 3.5 watts, so each Pi is likely drawing around 2.5 watts. Running CPU burn, which puts a full CPU load onto each Pi, power consumption goes up to 33 watts. So each Pi is now drawing around 7.5 watts. Thermally, the cluster performed a lot better than I expected. Running CPU burn on their CM5 modules without a heatsink usually results in them thermal throttling after a few seconds, but with the NanoCluster's relatively large fan blowing directly across the modules, the temperature started out around 26 to 29 degrees. After 30 minutes of testing, the temperature had stabilized around 60 degrees, and we didn't run into any thermal throttling. Again, this is without any heatsinks on the modules, which is quite impressive. I think that the flow of air across the CPU heat spreader, which is open on the sides, along with the case which forces air over the modules, works really well. The outer two modules run a little hotter than the inner ones, as expected, but they're still comfortably low. Fan noise is a little on the high side, being a 60mm fan. It runs at a consistent 58 decibels. Lastly, I ran an RPerf network test to check communication speeds between the nodes, and these all completed at a little under 950 megabits per second, which is good for a gigabit network connection between them. So that's the Sipeed NanoCluster, a seriously compact and well-designed little system that brings cluster computing into a form factor that you can literally hold in your hand. I really like that Sipeed have thought about the practical stuff, like power redundancy, integrated cooling, and a managed network switch. These all make it easy to experiment with clustering at home without a mess of cables and adapters. It's not going to replace your cloud server or your main NAS, but as a learning tool or a compact home lab, it's a great bit of hardware. And for under $100 for the boards and adapters, it's pretty hard to beat. Let me know in the comment section what you'd run on the cluster, and if there's anything else you'd like to see me test on it. Thanks for watching. Please remember to like this video if you enjoyed it, and subscribe for more tech and electronics projects, tutorials, and reviews.